And so now it's my privilege to introduce our keynote speaker for today, Sister Natalie Becquar. She's a Xavier sister, and she's the director of the National Service for Youth Evangelization and Vocations at the Bishops' Conference of France, as well as the vice president of the European Vocations Service. She's also been highly involved with the preparations for youth in France for the Synod, as well as being part of the meetings in Rome in preparation for the Synod. And so without further ado, welcome Sister Natalie.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Bonjour à tous et à toutes. Un très grand merci de m'accueillir ici. I'm very grateful to be here with all of you. It's my first time in Canada, so I discovered. And I want to thank Sister Mary Rover because she was the one who invited me here.
I was presented what I would share, and it's in the context of the preparation for the 2018 Synod of both, because the thing that we did in France for the consultation, but it's true that there also we had a chance to share different meetings in Rome where I met many of you. Some of you anyway, and it's the Synod, as you know, if it's being held now. We heard Father Ruzicka talk to us last night. It's because we're in a time of great change, and there are things that we have to evolve.
I'm sorry because my glasses are European and French glasses.
J'ai brisé mes verres hier, la semaine dernière. I'm going to talk to you based on this experience in this national service for the National Bishops' Conference Vocation Group. It's the sixth year I've been director, but for 4 years before that I was assistant director in the university world. The experience in Europe, every year we meet between those of us who are responsible for various countries, and I had a lot of collaboration in the past with other countries in Europe. It really helped me in my reflection and the work that I'm doing in France. And I am a Xavierian sister. My community is in close to Paris, not in the Diocese of Paris, but in the diocese right next door, which is called the Diocese of Nanterre. And for the last 3 years, the bishop, who is Bishop Michel Aupetit, who has just been named Archbishop of Paris when he was in the Diocese of Nanterre, asked me to be on his Episcopal Council. So it gave me a chance to work at a local level in the Episcopal Conference of Bishop Aupetit, who is now Archbishop of Paris. And so if I am here, it's because we had international collaborations, and we couldn't do the work we're doing in France without the experience of other countries. And Canada, of course, is part of this, and I'm trying to follow through with what you've done and what you're doing here. Now, based on all of this, I'll talk to you about the culture of vocations in today's world. It's a very limited perspective. I'm sorry, I don't know enough your particular context, and so what I'm going to suggest to you is simply for you to do your own enculturation here in Canada. We can't talk about the vocation culture in an abstract way. So my plan will be in three parts. I want to share these elements with you. We have to think of the vocational work with the young people based on a world vision, including the time where we find ourselves in, based on a vision of the church. And my concern will be in the follow-up of what Father Ruzicka talked about last night. I'm going to talk about today, after we've been working 5 years now with Pope Francis, and it's in that context of the church with Francis, Pope Francis, that I have a lot of references to the Pope. And we have a vision of the baptismal vocation as being the root of all vocations. So this is my plan, divided in three parts, three elements. Before continuing, I'd like to simply allow you to understand a little bit our national service for evangelizations of youth and for vocations, just so you give you a background of what brings me to see things in this way. In France, The National Center for Vocations was established in 1959. I think it was the first country that created a National Center for Vocations with a diocesan priest, Father Ivart, who died 3 months ago. And this priest, when the bishops asked him to create the National Center for the National Vocation Center, he said, "I don't want to do this alone. We have to have sisters." And so he started working with the sisters and with their brothers, and he asked the Archbishop of Paris to find religious for him who could help him. And he asked the Xavierans, my community. My community was involved from the outset. So in 2010, the bishops of France decided to merge, to put together the National Service for the Evangelization of Youth and Vocations. And so I think this, the synod is showing this intuition. And so we're one of 10 national services from the Conference of France. You know, France is quite different from Canada. We are a smaller country, if you want, geographically, but we're very centralized. So for us, there is in the church, there's a conference of bishops, which is quite organized with 10 national services, and our service is under a council of 6 bishops. And so if I'm there here today, I would not be able to be here without the team that I'm working with. And then with diocesan priests, 2 diocesan priests in the team. There are lay people, young and older, your sisters and brothers. And I'm going to conclude this part of the presentation by sharing the mission given to us by the bishops of France and what they understand by the word vocation. Our mission is really to serve the gospel proclamation of the young people, to allow each young person to encounter personally Christ. We heard Rachel yesterday talk about this. It's based on that personal encounter of Christ that the path is set up. So it's really our first mission is to allow for that personal encounter with Christ and to help each person to find their vocation and to accompany them in their human and spiritual growth. And this goes through the idea of developing a vocational culture. So it's in our mission is to develop a vocational culture which takes into account the diversity of calls and that has a particular attention to promote the vocation of priests and for religious life. And for this, we have networks, we train, we form, we're in link with all kinds of dioceses of France, but also all the movements and the communities. When I talk about vocational culture in Europe, we're very rooted in the vision of a fundamental document that I brought with me, which is called New Vocations for a New Europe, written in 1997. If you read this text, everything's there. Everything's there. And so the problem is that it's not implemented yet. And I hope that the synod, the youth synod, will help the implementation, and that's the major challenge today. The texts are all there. I'll quote a lot of texts, text of references. The problem is not the text. The texts are there. The problem is the local implementation in the country and in our churches. The vocational culture in Europe came to us based on an observation that the culture of secular society exists and creates a model of a person without vocation. The culture of vocation is for a context, therefore, where each man and woman spontaneously does not think of their life as a vocation. So I'm now going to talk to you and share some element of this vision of the world within which we need to think of the vocational culture and develop our action and our mission. This requires to discern the signs of the times, of course. It's the whole process of the church since Vatican II. The first observation, I like this quotation from Francis in Rio. "This is not an age of change, but a change of age." So the major issue today, or the problem today, is that we still have mental structures. We do things for the previous world, for the old world, and we're now at a crossroads of change, and we need now to have do an aggiornamento, update, And that's the major challenge for us today. The Pope Francis in his Evangelii Gaudium raised this issue. He said vocational work with young people has to face all the changes in society. And this is the same thing for vocations. So I think that we can't discern the signs of the time without listening and looking at the world through the young people's eyes. That's the major intuition of Pope Francis. It's the young people today who represent the new directions for humanity and for its future. And that's why working and accompanying young people is passionate. It's something fantastic because we see the new world appearing to us. So when at times we are stuck in the old world that's falling apart. So when I see the young people that I see, when I listen to them, I have no worries for the future of the church, for the future of religious life even. I am very trusting. But we have to accept that it will not look like what we know. We don't know what it'll look like in the future. It requires, therefore, great trust. So understanding better the situation of the young people, by understanding the world of today, we're able to discern the signs of the time. Pope Francis, in his last book, I don't think it's been translated in English yet, but I hope you'll have it soon. It's a book of God and the Young People. It came out 15 days ago, I think, in Italian and in French. This book says, to understand a young person today, we have to understand them as being somewhere on the move. And I would, if I was coherent, I would take the microphone and I would walk here in the hall for this. If we want to understand the world today, if we want to understand young people and being in mission with them, we have to be on the road. It'll be a major point, and I hope that by concluding, we'll all go off on the road. Pope Francis says, he's asked, how do you see the young people? What is the image that comes to mind? And the Pope says, the young person, I see the young person as a boy or a girl with quick feet who seeks their path and enters into the world and looks on the horizon with eyes full of hope, full of a future and full of vision. The young person walks on both feet. The young person is always ready to go on, to go off. He's always ready to walk on the road and to go out. And I think that Pope Francis is very strategic. We heard where the Synod on Young People came from. So the Pope understood with others that the young people today are the first elements of the transformation in the world. They're the ones that are going, they're the real interveners, the real actors of the new world that's appearing, that's coming up. And they can also be the first positive actors to bring about a more just, more fraternal world. The goal of the Synod is not to have young people in the church and to have more people in our congregations or our seminaries. No, that we can hope for this, but for Francis, I think, and the goal of the Synod is the young people for the world, for the future of the world, for the saving of the world and the planet. I mean, this generation, with everything it has, is very is invited to participate, and they await only this, to shake up the world, to make the world better. And I think that they're the ones also who help us to help the church to advance in terms of its reform. And that's what by Francis are the first movers of the reform that he's trying to implement in the church. In the pre-synod, where I had a chance to participate in the end of March, you'll be able to read the document. The final document, if you haven't read it yet, you have to read this. The vision of the young people and of the church is quite in the vein of what Pope Francis is hoping for. And then just a few images to understand this and the work that's behind our pastoral approach. Five letters. You may know them already, simply to understand the young people today. It's an epic culture. First of all, E, like experience. The key word there is E, as an experience. We heard it yesterday on from Rachel. We have to do experiences. Our pastoral work has to be, we have to propose experiences to the young people, strong experiences. A culture, P, culture of participation. The first thing that the young people are asking is to be active. And if they were here, there are a few over there, they have enough They have to interact and participate in the room, and so some young people want to participate. The eye, like an image, what they want music, they want videos. We need to inculturate ourselves, inculturate our view, our vision into images. Often we remain in the culture of the written word only. That's the change today, from the written word to image. And you know, they're connected, they all have their iPhone and their smartphone or whatever it is. Three images to continue to understand young people today, where we need to work. The first image is a network. This is what they use, they use network. The young people are connected through social media and network. Network, networks are relationships, interpersonal relationships. The world today establishes relationship at the core, at the heart. If the church is seen simply as a structure, as an institution up there, forget it. The young people will not connect to this. Why has Francis connected so well with the young people, as Father Tom Ruzicka said last night? It's because Francis is in sync with this young people, the culture of young people today, culture of proximity, of relationship, of presence. It's a generation which I call co-generation, like all the other sharing, car sharing, all the sharings. If you had young people here to talk, they wouldn't be alone. There would be 10 of them talking in the room. So the second image, very important. The young people build a new world, a world of plurality. You know, in Toronto, I think, is a city that has the greatest number of various nationalities in the world. It's a mosaic. Toronto is a mosaic. A very strong image, you know, in Canada is a mosaic. It's a natural place of young people today. They are comfortable with diversity. They are comfortable with plurality. They're full of paradoxes. We heard Andrew yesterday. He said, he described all the kinds of prayers and the rules of a church, which is a family in mosaic, where each little piece, the traditionals, the charismatic, everybody finds their place. And that's what's happening in the priesthood at work. Now the last image, the image of the sea. We could look at the lake that's here, Lake Ontario. Our world today is in the prepared document. There's a very strong theme that's used, and it's the whole question of the liquid society. We have passed from the land to the sea. If we want to think the world today, the world of tomorrow, we have to continue the conference, not in the Sheraton Hotel, but we have to go on the boat together to be on the sea. And the sea is mobile, the sea is shaking. But the major challenge today is to see how we can find stability, balance, rooting, not on the land anymore, but on the water, on the sea. The world today is a fluid, liquid world, and that's what the young people experience today. So this requires, and this will be the conclusion of my first part here, we have to be on the move. We have to be in the move if we want, and we need to have a vision that evolves. So what I'm saying here, I wouldn't have said it 2 years ago. I certainly wouldn't have said it the same way. 2 years, 15 years ago, I didn't think this way. It's by listening to the young people, by trying to read the signs of the time with them and to understand that this vision evolves. And this is the great challenge for the world today, for the church today. And this requires that we have to be constantly in a sense, in a context of discernment. Just to give you a few indications of hope and light, in France today, a very, very secular country, you know, France is secular for a long time, we observe a renewal, a spiritual renewal, a religious renewal in that country. It's very interesting. I think that we're entering into a sort of post-secular society. The question of the young people today is the question of meaning, the meaning of life. How can we make choices? But also, it does not express itself in the same way. This spiritual renewal and religious renewal is not made in an institutional context, only through the sacraments, for example. This is done by much more by the participation to events and through the quest what is at the heart of the young people today? We heard it yesterday in some of the witnessing yesterday, is their personal relationship to God, what I called the mystical adventure. What the young people are looking for today is a relational church. In the pre-synod document, there has a very strong sentence there. An abstractal church is a relational church. So a church on the road, a church of mercy, is undertaking the Emmaus walk. And I think that's what we have to do, look at. The second part, okay, this is the second part now. Just going to have a glass of water. Helps the camels. I know. So we can't think of the vocational culture without this vision of the world, this understanding of the world itself, and without understanding and integrating the present state that the church finds herself in. We heard it yesterday. The church, where we're at with today, is in a time of reform with Evangelii Gaudium as a GPS. It's very important to have a GPS. Yesterday I came with Sister Catherine from my community in Toronto. She didn't have any GPS and we got lost. So thank God I had my smartphone. Afterwards we were able to find. So all the pastoral work today, I think the Evangelii Gaudium puts the mission, the missionary transformation of the church as a goal. That's our GPS. If we go on a boat, we're going to have the GPS of Evangelii Gaudium, the missionary option. Everything we need to think in terms of the pastoral understanding is not to have people who feed us. We need to be at work and envision with a vision on the world. And so I think that today we're in a new phase of the reception of Vatican II, actually, and I will explain this. In the States, 15 days ago, or a month ago, for the 5 years of Pope Francis, maybe you've heard about this, there was some kind of colloquium in Villanova University on the 5 years of Pope Francis' pontificate, and among the points raised, and I agree with this, the interpretation of Pope Francis about Vatican II. Pope Francis is the first pope who was not at Vatican II. All the other popes were at Vatican II. And so, Professor Fagioli tells us the interpretation of Council of Vatican II by Francis is the most important event in church history, he says, in the last 4 centuries. His teaching, what he's trying to do, renews us, reforms the church to make it more aware of modernity, to make it more universal and less Eurocentric. So the problem from the outset with the Vatican is that the Vatican Council have been made up of a lot of Italians, and I'm seeing now that the Pope Francis comes from the other side of the pond or of the ocean, and that's the challenge today. And Professor Cagioli Fancy says the Pope Francis perceives that the issue in reflection of Vatican II is not to be reinterpreted or restricted. Rather, it needs to be implemented and extended. That's exactly what I just said. This is the question of the implementation. So for Francis, it's essential to have a proper recontextualization of the Catholic Church. We're not in Vatican II's context anymore. We need now a new aggiornamento of the aggiornamento of Vatican II, to find once more, to recover the missionary dimension of the church. And what is at the heart of that reform of the church, of that missionary transformation, for this renewal, what's at the core? It's synodality. Synodality. And one, if you have a text from Francis to read the text given on the 17th of October 2015 to commemorate the 50 years of the anniversary of the institution of the synod. It's not one of his major texts, but it says here, the world in which we live and which we are called to serve, even with its contradictions, its paradoxes, demands that the Church strengthen cooperation in all areas of her mission. It is precisely this path of synodality which God expects of the Church for the third millennium. So for me, this is something that's quite major. The path of synodality is the path for the vocational work, for the youth work, for all pastoral work. What is synodality? He talks about, he says, synodality is a church that listens. And when I had the pre-synod with the young people, I was called to that. Listen, 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 in order to walk together, all together, lay, pastors, and bishops. Synodality, as a constitutive element of the Church, offers us the most appropriate interpretive framework for understanding the hierarchical ministry itself. So, Church and Synod are synonymous. Church and Synod are synonymous. Synod means walking together. Synod means walking together. You understand that in this world on the move in the sea, the purpose is to walk together. We can say navigate together. The first symbol of the Church in the Gospels is the boat. It's the boat. So we're all invited today to undertake a culture, a vocational culture, undertake our mission in the boat by going out on this sea with the breath of the Holy Spirit in our sails. And I think that my whole experience is to, for these last 2 years of preparation of the Synod of the Young People, but even beforehand, and what I experienced in Rome, I think that synodality is truly the key for the vocational work with the young people. It's not without the young people, it's with the young people, listening to them. They are the protagonists that we can, with them we can develop this pastoral approach. The second issue is quite major, which is the key for the vocational culture, and I'd like to develop this further, is the ecclesiology of communion. Ecclesiology of Vatican II, which developed a lot by John Paul II, which is spirituality of communion. And this is why I'm happy to be here with many dioceses and communities. We're always remembering that we have to serve together the common good of the Church for the common good of the world, and not serving the particular need of the community foremost. No, we need to change things in our minds to be able to promote together all the vocations. The young people don't belong to anybody in particular. Fine if we can accompany one person who will go into a community or off to another country, even if it's not easy. But the ecclesiology of communion, so it not just remain a theoretical concept, it's not easy to understand. I mean, the Trinity and communion is not easy to understand. No, but in the field, it's very difficult to implement sometimes. So it requires a culture of collaboration, and I will develop that between the diversity of vocations, and in particular, with all those who are on charisms and institutions, Peter and Paul from the beginning of the Church. We haven't finished understanding collaboration. You know, I encounter a lot of bishops who are responsible for the diocese, and they say, oh, religious communities take away young people. Some people say, these bishops, these dioceses, they don't understand what's going on. So how can, what really helps us in experience? Well, how can we understand in the ecclesiology of communion? We need to undertake common missionary projects. It's communion that's the missionary, that all be one, so that the world may believe. And in the World Youth Days, since 1997, we've been preparing the World Youth Days. Everybody, dioceses, the new communities, the old communities, traditional communities, the movements. And this creates a culture of collaboration and of communion. So we have to learn from one another. We need to work on common projects and to develop approaches in partnership with others. For me, a key word here is partnership. That means I'm not doing it as if I was only alone. Last part. So, the first part was to understand the world itself, the vision of the world in which we find ourselves. The second part of my presentation is the vision of what is the church today, what is the call to synodality and to communion. The last part of this, to think up or think about vocational culture, we need to reroot ourselves very strongly in a vision of baptismal identity as being the heart and the source. We have a lot more in common among vocations than what distinguishes us. It's important to remember that. We have to look at how we see the diversity of vocations. And I want to develop this because our mindsets don't always help us. We can't think of vocation without the mission, because vocation is mission. We can't talk about vocations and the culture of vocations without coming back to the fundamental vocation of the church herself. All the vocations are rooted and have their meaning within the vision, the main vision of the church's vocation. The vocation of the church is to continue the mission of Christ by cooperating to the mission of the Holy Spirit. It's to serve the world. We never forget this. The vocational approach is not to have more bodies because we want a big community or more seminarians. No, the world is awaiting for us. The world is thirsting. So we can't think of the vocational culture without thinking also of the ministry of the church. And to fulfill her mission, the church needs to organize herself in different ministries. It's evolved over the centuries, of course. Maybe it'll still evolve. There is therefore an important action between the questions of the theology of ministries and the theology of vocation. And all this is under construction right now. We see that there are we're thinking about maybe we'll have women deacon one day, the different ministries might change, the lay ministries in the church might change also. This is a major question for the church to discuss today. All vocation is rooted in the church. Each year the Pope has a message for Vocation Sunday. In 2016 it was the church is mother of vocations. The call, God's call, always comes to us through the mediation of the community. Vocations are born within the church. Nobody is called exclusively for a particular region or for a group or for an ecclesial movement, but each person is called for the church and for the world. This is very important, and it's highlighted here in this text. In Evangelii Gaudium, Pope Francis reminds us, and this is really the heart of the vocational culture and the ministry among the four vocations today, is to help each young person discover this call. I am in mission on this world, on this earth. What the young people are looking for mostly today is the need to be useful, the need to find meaning for their lives. If we allow them to discover that their lives have meaning and contribute in mission on this world, then we could undertake a more clear vocational approach. What is fundamental in what the Pope Francis talks about, which is the follow-up to Vatican II, by insisting strongly today on a vision of the church as people of God with everyone. So, but it's in another text that's really important, written by Francis, I don't know if you read it, the letter to Cardinal Ouellet in 2016. You know Cardinal Ouellet, he's from Canada. He's president of the Pontifical Commission for Latin America. It's a very quick text, very subtle, very important. The Pope Francis there says how laity is our baptism allows us to enter the church. Before being a priest or religious or anything else like that, we are lay baptized persons. the church is not an elite of priests or consecrated pure persons or bishops. No, the church is...
But
the church is the holy people of God.
And
Pope Francis insists constantly on the universal call to holiness. He said it 15 days ago when he published his new apostolic exhortation, Gaudete et Exultate. We've heard about this yesterday. He insists on the fact that God calls each person to live true life, full life. It calls each person to happiness, asks us to be holy. And it's this vision that has to support any kind of vocational approach. It's the insistence also we have in a preparatory document to the Synod, which is really a very broad approach of vocations, the vocation to love, to life, which will translate in a series of choices. And our role is to help the young people to recognize and to implement a call to love and a call to life in abundance, to accompany the maturation of their authentic freedom. And so this is the perspective. The problem is that I don't know what it's like in Canada, but in many countries and in France, when we talk about vocation, for a young person anyway, when we use the word vocation, well, he or she hears is the church is trying to recruit priests, or vocations is for the priests and the sisters and brothers. So there's a major change we have to undertake in terms of the theology of vocation to allow the young people to understand that what is the biblical understanding of vocation, vocation as a call, and the meaning given by Vatican II that expresses itself in the universal call to holiness. It's not what many people think about when they think of the word vocation, because many persons don't know they have a vocation. And in the preparatory document to the Synod, we need a simple and clear understanding of vocation to highlight a sense of a call and mission, of desire and aspiration, which makes it a concept more relatable to the young people at this stage of their lives. Vocation has sometimes been presented as an abstract concept perceived as too far out of the reach of the minds of many. Often, in the way we talk about vocation, we often have witnesses of vocation, but the story is told, I received a call from up here, it was clear, but that's not the young people's experience. The process of a vocation goes up and down and up and down. I mean, there's doubts and there's certitudes, and so if the young people perceive the church, the priests, the witnesses, as perfect persons who have it all together with a clear vision, then they can't identify to that. They can't fit into that. What the young people asked us the most in the pre-synod document is a church that is human, a church that recognizes its errors, a church that recognizes it's fallible, and which is human, all while being the witness of the Holy Spirit. Because, you know, they can... That's how they see themselves. So a lot of work needs to be done to help the young people to better understand what vocation is all about in all its diversity. And I think that what I discerned and heard during all these years and where we are at now in terms of preparing the Synod is that today the major question that young people ask themselves is, how can I establish my identity? And not only with others, with multiple models, we can choose everything. We can choose our gender, we can choose our religion, we can choose all kinds of things. But the question is, who am I really? Who am I really? How can I make choices? How can I choose the right course for my life? And so the vocation is the most beautiful gift that we can offer to the young people and to the world today, but who are seeking meaning, asking them what is our identity, and to helping them to understand how to live together in a context of diversity. So I think that we're invited, really, the world is invited, the world is waiting for the good news of vocation. We have a great responsibility to proclaim this good news, to allow the world to understand that each person has a unique and particular vocation, and that we need to offer to everybody what will help them to live in this world today, build themselves up, to build the common home of humanity together. So in France, when we talk about vocation together, I like to present four dimensions that we need to clarify. First, the dimension is the call to life. Every human being has a call to life, to love. That's what we call our human vocation. The second dimension of this, for those who are baptized, is the universal call to holiness, baptismal vocation. We can say today the vocation of being a missionary disciple. Third call and vocation that we need to clarify is the call to a way of life, a lifestyle. There's marriage, priesthood, and consecrated life. And here, I know a lot of people are working a lot on this, on their job. Work is a lot of very important. So in Christian vocation, work itself is a vocation. And it's a way in which each one articulates these four dimensions, which makes our call specific and particular, that a call that God has for me. I'm going to go very quickly because the time flies. But just to show you the coherence of this vision, I'm going to invite you to look at different texts that present the vocation to marriage. Amoris Laetitia, we're talking today about marriage as a vocation, which requires a whole discernment process. The situation of religious life, I would have liked to have developed it even more. I don't have enough time. That we're going through a lot of transformation right now, recompositions. The year of consecrated life helped us to deepen our vocation. It was a beautiful present given to us. It's a time of Kairos. And if you want to take, I invite you to read the result of consecrated life made by the Congregation for Consecrated Life. New wine in new vessels. I think that this is a new call for religious life. Today, this religious life has to open itself up to new modalities for following Christ, maybe even new structures, and we need to change. So this is a vision of consecrated life. I developed it in other texts, so I'm going to skip over this quickly, but the most important one is really to think of religious life, even if it is on the side of the charisms and prophetic life. Religious life is part of the church life. Within the whole church, religious life is an expression of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, but we're not outside of the church, we're in the church. In this vision of a new communion ecclesiology. And the vision of the priest, I think Cardinal Lacroix will talk about it tomorrow. Read the new ratio for the formation of seminarians. Very interesting. This presents completely the same vision of the priest as a disciple who comes from the community, Christian community, goes back to it, and where the formation of priests is a single formation from baptism, the formation of missionary disciples, the seminary formation, ongoing formation, which is fundamental. So it's a continuum, the formation. That's why the vocational work is integrated as one of the chapters of the new ratio in these seminaries. So it's the same vision that we have. And therefore, the bishops in particular have a very strong responsibility for vocations, priests and vocations, have to encourage strong cooperation between priests, between consecrated people and lay people, and this cooperation has to be promoted with all the associations and movements. There's a request in all the official documents in Rome to have a diocesan vocation committee made up of the different vocations. And to think of this question of vocations, I'd like to conclude with an image, because we have a lot of difficulty, at least in France, we have a lot of difficulty to think of the difference that is not in part of a hierarchy. The major problem to implement Vatican II and its vision is to think of the diversity of vocations, but in a non-hierarchical view, but rooted in the baptismal identity. Why? Well, because often we think of a sphere. Spontaneously, we think of a sphere. What is an illusion? In other words, we think each vocation has the same kind of relationship with baptism, that we're undertaking, fulfilling our baptism on different pathways, but in a symmetrical way, if we're priest, religious, bishop, or deacon. I invite you, after a French theologian whose name is Father Luc Farissier, who enlightened me by presenting this image, I'm inviting you to think and use the example of the polyhedron. You've heard about it in Evangelii Gaudium. What is a polyhedron? It's a way of establishing unity by keeping differences. You can see polyhedron. I'd like to come back on this. The polyhedron reflects the convergence of all its parts. It's a way of bringing together unity, but preserves the distinctiveness. So we need to think in a more complex way of the polyhedron, because the ministry of the diocesan priest is structured. There's no church without Eucharist and priests. But religious life is also in a different context. It's a gratuitous gift. In a way, the church can live without religious life, and yet all the bishops know if there's no religious life in a diocese, there's something lacking. But it's not placed, it's not in the same relationship to baptism. Marriage, on the other hand, also, the debate today on the theology of marriage is that it's natural, it's a sacrament, whatever. And so this means concretely that often we have a tendency, and when we talk about vocations, we talk only of the priests and sometimes of sisters or brothers. Sometimes we put them all on the same level. We have to give the same time for the priests and for the religious and for marriage. I think we have to think very differently about this in a very complex way, and this is why we can think of this polyhedron only in a context of movement, in the context of something that's changing. And I'm going to conclude with this. This culture of vocations today, with all the visions that I've tried to present here to you, this has to be fundamentally a culture of common listening to the Holy Spirit, and a culture of reciprocity, a culture of dialogue, a culture of cooperation, ultimately a culture of encounter, which is very open, very interesting for Francis. And we can discover each vocation. We can't discover the vocation independently with others. We have to think here in relational terms. The culture of vocation today has a basis of a common experience, a way of thinking that is relational, because the difference cannot be grasped. If we try to define everything too much, we're not in the context of the Holy Spirit. And really, I conclude with this. I think that in this vision that I'm sharing with you, to think of vocational culture, we need to have a passion for the world, a passion for Christ, a passion for the church. So a vision of vocation that is rooted in the Trinitarian theology, to serve the world, so it become more and more this common home, as described in Laudato Si. Thank you very much.